love so long to see a revolution somehow. And love explode and bring the day to life. Love so long to bring a revolution somehow.
Welcome to the Missouri Freedom Initiative. Guys, it's the day before Easter, so I wanted to say happy Easter to everyone. And the first song, of course, was God's Not Dead by the Newsboys. But what we're listening to right now comes from, of course, Slave to Servant, Escape Babylon. So we're listening to the song Escape Babylon, which is on their album. Guys, look at that debt, $34,613 billion. My goodness, it's really a shame that the entire world hasn't lost faith in the dollar yet. Apparently, they're waiting for a certain number for everyone to start using something else as currency. How about gold and silver? I wonder if these other countries are thinking about that. Oh, that's right, they are. They're hoarding gold and silver in their central banks in the Eastern world. I forgot to mention that. All right, gang, well, that's enough of the debt. Let's bring up the gang here. On our Gilded Chat, we have a wonderful panel this evening. I want to say that we've got some special guests tonight. We have Kirby Lane. joining us from Rogue Politics tonight, and she's going to deliver something for us here in a few minutes. And that's a lot of information on SB 727 and what you can do and why it's a problem. But also we have Caleb with us tonight, also known as Liberty Revolutionary. We have Voodoo Queen with us tonight. We have Shane with us tonight. Gretchen's with us tonight. Ancient Tom is with us tonight. And we also have Retha, also known as Wonder Woman. And so we got a lot of stuff going on this week, this coming up week. You know, not only is it Easter, but also, too, we have, you know, gold and silver legislation starting to move its way through the system right now. But on top of that, we also have a bill that needs to die. SB 727. Thank you, Senator Koenig, for visiting this monstrosity on us. Let's talk about that a little bit tonight, why it needs to die. And one more thing I want to say before we turn over to Kirby. I did send an email out like I do every Saturday, but something unfortunate happened with a lot of Gmail addresses that got bounced back to me, over 250. I didn't count, but it's somewhere between 250 and 300 bounced back. And that's because they said the right security protocol was not used for sending the email, which, of course, it was. This is the second time this has happened. So if you have a Gmail address, I wouldn't mind an email from you if you have a different address, because this has happened twice now. Email me, let me know what your Gmail address is, and let me know another address that I could actually put you on the mail list with. And that way, folks with Gmail don't miss out on the emails we send out, because they're critical, just like the one that went out today. So without further ado, I think we're going to go ahead and start with Kirby Lane from Rogue Politics. And she's going to kind of regale us with the story of what is SB 727, why the entirety of the conservative grassroots want this bill killed, public schools even want it killed. And we actually are siding with the public schools. We have different reasons, of course, but it still needs to die. So without further ado, Kirby, welcome to the show, and thank you for being with us.
Thank you for having me, Pat.
You bet.
So it needs to die for numerous reasons. The only people that appear to want it are DESE and the private schools, because the private schools are not realizing what strings will occur if this passes. So the bill started out as a 12-page bill that was expanding Krista Finelli's Mo Scholars bill from 2021 to allow more people to use the what they like to call not vouchers. What it does is, it takes people donate to this EAO, which is an educational assistance organization, and the people that donate to them are given a tax credit. So they're calling it a tax credit, but it's not a tax credit for me or you. It's a tax credit for the kind-hearted people who donate to these EAOs. So the reason why homeschoolers are against it, because I know that's going to be a big portion of your listeners, is because it creates a distinctively similar group of homeschoolers called family-based education. So what they've done here is they've taken homeschoolers out of their state statute, which is 167, was originally 167.031. That's what it is currently. They've moved homeschoolers into their own section. It's 163.012. They created an entirely new section, 167.013. And it creates this family-based education. And what they did was copy and paste the homeschool statute over. And Koenig even said that in the committee hearing for the House the other day. He said, we copied the definition. The only real difference is that under homeschoolers, it says may not be an FPE school. And under the FPE school, it says may not accept funds under this program.
Okay.
So the concern we have here is that West Virginia tried something similar, and as soon as it passed, the lawyers came in and said, because of the Equal Protection Clause in the United States Constitution, these groups of similar people have to have equal protection under the law. So bills started going through that were going to bring homeschoolers under the same regulations as these FPE schoolers, which we know they have more regulations, and this was done partially on Mo Scholars and then partially in rules by the treasurer afterwards. So I don't know what your listeners know about the previous bill in 2021, But it requires standardized testing if you take this money. Background checks on anyone over the age of 18. That was done in rules. You have to show your curriculum plan, and you have to be prepared to show your reports, your logging, your records to the treasurer's office at any time they request.
Kirby, can I ask you a question about certifications for teachers? Because this bill seems to want like 60 certifications. We're talking above and beyond, you know, the standard college education, you know, to be a licensed teacher. But can you talk about certs?
So I think what you're talking about is the DESE certification. So there's a section in this bill that creates a new certification created by a not-for-profit. We don't know who yet. So some not-for-profit is supposed to create an 18-hour training that would be, that shall be accepted by private schools. Mm-hmm. So it says that I think public school teachers, I'd have to pull it back out. I believe public school teachers may take this, but private schools shall accept it.
Yep.
So we have a lot of concern here about whether or not everyone's going to have to take it. There is some concern that there may be some lawsuits if anybody tries to deny, you know, tries to not take a kid under Mo Scholars. There might be some lawsuits, which would mean that every private school has to have the certification. Mm-hmm. In order to participate in an EAO, which is essentially every school, if they allow for lawsuits, you know, if you deny somebody under Mo Scholars. So the other concern is that if two teachers present themselves for a job at a private school, and one of them has this DESE certification and one of them does not have this DESE certification, and the school wants to hire the one that does not have it, that opens them up for lawsuits because it says they shall have, private schools shall accept the certification.
Understood.
So because of the wording of that section, that's concerning. Also, we don't want DESE to have any more regulation over us.
Yep. And so, the regulations that they're talking about putting on the public schools are even somewhat punitive, it seems. The public schools are not happy with this bill.
No, the public schools don't appear to be either. And Pat, I will be honest, I focus mainly on homeschoolers. One thing that the public schools do have in here is if they want to go to a four-day school week, mm-hmm. If they're over a certain size, they have to put it to a vote of the people.
Okay.
So, I mean, people aren't going to want to vote that in themselves because they lose a day of their free babysitter. So that was one thing that I did notice in there about public schools. So there is some concern that this bill will require. There's some valid concern that this bill would require homeschoolers to register because of wording where they added us to an enrollment section mm-hmm. of the law, which we aren't currently in. What else they've done here. There's an extraordinary amount of data collection and data mining in this bill. There is a lot of data to be had and to be sold here in numerous portions and on numerous sections. They also added, prior to this bill, the treasurer is the one who promulgates the rules. In this bill, it adds collaboration with DESE and the Mo Scholars Board. So the Mo Scholars Board is made up of mostly unelected bureaucrats. They also are modifying the Mo Scholars Board this year and removing the commissioner of the Office of Administration and adding in a member of one of these NGOs, these non-governmental organizations, the EAOs. So the educational assistance organizations will have a seat at the table now to help write the rules.
Okay, gotcha.
So then they also have what's called an elementary literacy fund in here. So the elementary literacy fund will cost taxpayers $5 million a year. It's a to-be-determined non-for-profit that would have a reading program for children where these children are sent books to their home that they choose themselves. It specifies that the child chooses. And then they have follow-up calls at least weekly. Follow-up calls, text messages, emails at least weekly with this company. This is opening us up to LGBTQ, DEI, critical race theory, anything that you can imagine, because there's no guidelines in here to stop it. It increases teacher salaries. That is another public school. It puts in the statutes a minimum salary, which is fine for districts that have a lot of money, but that's really going to harm smaller school districts if they can't afford it and don't have the tax base. There's some concern that this bill, and we haven't gotten any clarification on this, that it might add a graduation credit requirement for homeschoolers, which we don't currently have. And it definitely is going to expand DESE over the reach of private education. So most dangerous thing about this is the way that it is worded. It would only take a clarification bill where they change one or two words to make everything in here mandatory.
Okay.
This bill is, it's just very dangerous. And it's 167 pages. It started out at 12 and it's now 167.
And that was, there were so many amendments to this bill. It's just incredible.
Yes.
I don't know that I've seen a bill 167 pages long in the Missouri legislature before.
I'm unsure. There's a lot of Democrat agendas in here. They did not filibuster it. They didn't vote for it, but they did agree to not filibuster it to get it through the Senate because their priorities are in here. They were happy with this bill.
Okay.
This is a uniparty bill.
Yes. Okay. Mm-hmm.
And actually,
very much a uniparty.
I got a question already for you, Kirby, that has come up in the chat. Yes. Do we know what committee this will be assigned to?
It is in the House currently in the Special Education the Special Committee on Education Reform.
Okay. There we go. And also, in lieu of this, and by the way, a lot of our people already know about this. I just want to say something real quick here about the video quality. Gilded is glitching tonight. It's holding together, but it's glitching. This is a Gilded problem. There's nothing we can do about it. So just so you guys know, if you're seeing the flickering of the screen here on the presentation, that's what it's, it's basically just Gilded. Okay, so a lot of folks know about this bill. It's been extremely controversial up in Jefferson City. And there's been a lot of blowback from the constitutional conservative grassroots on this bill, and somewhat of a cold reception from a lot of people up, in Jefferson City from the grassroots who are normally pretty much listened to. So
we've been completely ignored. We've been almost completely ignored, not completely, because there are some people listening, but it's few and far between.
Okay. I'm sorry. I'm going to interrupt with one more question here from Guitar Authority, who asked the first question. The question is it the same committee that the House Education Bill with Bishop Davison as the chair?
Yes, it is.
Okay, yes. Okay, the plot thickens. Okay, well, the grassroots some kind of have an answer for this, by the way. And it's actually going to be a very public gathering up in Jefferson City on Wednesday. Let me get you the date real quick. I did put something in every chat on all of our streams, and you guys will see that it's handsoffhomeschool.org, and that's directly related to what I'm about to talk about. Kirby's going to talk about it too. That'll be Wednesday, the 3rd of April. There is actually going to be somewhat of an event up in Jefferson City, and my understanding is, and I'm not 100% sure, but once you get on the list, you get all the details, is basically homeschool dads are going to meet with a special contingent of House reps that really, truly want to hear the homeschoolers' concern on this bill. Now, with the money and the power behind this bill right now, which is something that we rarely see, this much money and this much power behind something, this is really important for people to take into account and try to get up to Jeff City. So do you want to talk a little bit about that, the homeschool dads?
So I'm not in on the planning phase of that. I'm just a contact for them, but they will be meeting up there and talking with as many reps as they can possibly talk to relate to the game on this, because people didn't want to hear anything about it for some reason until, I guess, this week. So it's already been heard in the committee in the House the other day, which was honestly weird in itself because they cut testimony to 2 minutes a person. So no one really had very much time to speak. And the people that were in support of the bill on more than one occasion were given extra time to finish their testimony, whereas people on that were opposed were not. And they were asked questions of when they were in support of often, whereas the people, most of the people who were in opposition were not asked a lot of questions. So the whole hearing itself was very odd. And so Wednesday, the dads will be going up there because we feel like the dads are a force to be reckoned with, you know, and when the dads come out and they speak out and they say, this has to stop, hands off our children, we don't want any of this, we feel the reps will maybe hear us louder. We would like to have as many as we can possibly get.
Yep. So, I mean, in honest to God, this is a really strange one for me to talk about because normally as a grassroots guy, I'm used to actually being able to be heard, at least be heard, even if they disagree with me. But in some cases, you know, it's been very public on Twitter, even Ben Baker, you know, when I was actually explaining the data collection side of this, and we haven't even gotten into that. He was saying, oh, Pat, you're falling for the, you know, the Democrat talking points. You know, he'd say that very publicly on Twitter. And that's kind of strange, you know, to have that sort of thing happen. I mean, these guys know me up there. They know that I'm not falling for Democrat talking points at all. The homeschoolers have very grave concerns with this bill. But so do the public schools, and so should the private schools. Honestly, the private schools are getting nailed here. It's not a good deal for Missouri. And also, too, we enjoy an enormous amount of autonomy with homeschooling in the state of Missouri. Possibly the freest state to homeschool in. I think that's a valid argument that anyone could make who lives here. And a lot of that autonomy is going to go away. Now I will say there's a caveat here. This is a poison carrot, right? And you don't have to take the poison carrot. But the fact is people in Jefferson City are creating a poison carrot and dangling it in front of people in a time where we're in consistent, never-ending inflation. And so at some point, they're going to bite on the carrot, you know, at some point, you know, which is getting the voucher to get their kids out of the public school system and do something, you know, like private schooling or homeschooling or charter schooling. So,
well, and I do want to add something about the EAOs. Sure. They're able to create their own rules as well. They're a non-governmental organization. So they're able to create their own rules for the program as well. Mm-hmm. So that could affect private schools at any point. So there are currently 6 EAOs in the state of Missouri. And as far as we are aware, none of them are going to even accept homeschoolers next year. Mm-hmm. Some have been told that there will be one, but we can't find any proof of that. So at this point, they're potentially bringing us under additional regulation using this bill, but we can't even use the money if we wanted to.
Yep. Everything about this is wild. Ms. Diakison is putting in some interesting stuff here. She says, there's another bill that is about homeschoolers that was scheduled to be heard and exact this past Thursday afternoon.
Yes.
But they didn't have a quorum. That is very unusual. Go ahead.
They didn't have a quorum for the hearing on 7/27 either. And Bishop Davidson acknowledged it and said, we don't have a quorum, but that's okay because we don't need it just for public comment. So they didn't have a quorum then either. And this bill that Misty's speaking of is, like, I think it's HCB1. Best we can figure it is a House committee bill. We don't really understand how it came about. We haven't seen this before, us personally. But it was an HCB House committee bill.
Yep. And so what I've heard, and once again, I mean, I hear things once in a while, and they don't always pan out. What I've heard is this is going to get voted on very, very quickly and sped through a rules committee and get on the floor as quickly as possible, possibly as early as Thursday. No guarantees, but so you've heard the same thing?
I've heard the same thing. I've heard that, yes, Tuesday voting and Thursday floor.
Okay. So it has to be in rules for 24 hours. Or I'm sorry, it can't go on the floor within 24 hours of it getting out of rules. So that means they're probably going to put it in rules on Tuesday. and then get it out of that committee on Tuesday so they can have it out Thursday.
And there's a really good chance they're not going to allow amendments on the floor of this bill as well. And if that's the case, then the only place that we can go right now is the committee.
Okay. Warrior Class 3 has a question for you. Although she did answer that earlier, but she didn't specifically address how it affects homeschoolers. The question is, how does this bill affect homeschoolers?
This bill affects homeschoolers because it creates a different class of homeschoolers that are the same, but they say different, and they're saying that it's shielding us by giving us our own statute. So we've been moved from what statute we were currently in to a different section of Missouri statute. And they're telling us that it's to insulate us, but they've created this additional set, this additional type of homeschooler that uses the money, and they have additional regulations on them that we don't have. And the concern is that they will use the Equal Protection Clause of the Constitution to then force us under those regulations, because the Equal Protection Clause says that same or similar groups of people have to have equal protection under the law.
I need to bring up something, because let's talk about the two definitions. FPE or PFE or something?
Yes.
Okay. And then the homeschoolers.
Family-based education.
Family-based education, FPE, thank you.
Yes.
Now, what we heard, interestingly enough, from one of our people here in the state, is that they did the same thing in West Virginia. And what they ended up doing was some kind of legal hocus-pocus, merging the two definitions into one, therefore forcing homeschoolers to actually start partaking in the data collection with the state agency that monitors that. What people may not know is that last week I was speaking at the Prepared Homestead meeting, Travis Maddox's Prepared Homestead meeting, and there was a guy there from North Carolina who said they did the same thing to us. And they left for homeschool freedom. And I believe he might have said that they did that 2 or 3 years ago in North Carolina.
Mm-hmm. So, and the difference between West Virginia and us is that West Virginia doesn't have term limits.
Yep.
So the same people that pass this and force this upon them have to answer to these grassroots homeschoolers every year. We don't have that protection. That's a protection we don't have that they do.
Yep.
And these definitions are exactly the same. Senator Koenig said when he was presenting this bill in the House, he said, we copied the definition from homeschoolers over here, with the exception of this says is not an FPE school. Okay. So even if they think they've insulated us, the senator, whether knowingly or not, went into a committee and said that he copied the definition. He gave them the ammunition they need to do it.
Okay. Well, that being the case, actually, Misty said something here, too. For a bill to get heard and exact in the same committee meeting, that's, somewhat an unusual thing. But also, she says, DESE will oversee homeschoolers as well as the treasurer's office will be overseeing homeschoolers. That's interesting.
Correct. They're allowed to promulgate the rules. They have to converse to promulgate the rules along with most scholars' board. Mm-hmm. So it would be all three. It would be the treasurer's office, Moe's Scholars Board, and DESE.
Okay. All right. So apart from homeschool dads on Wednesday, and once again, guys, I put the link in on every platform we're on right now. It was in the email too, handsoffhomeschool.org. Homeschool dads, we really need you to step up, even if it means taking the day off from work. This is really critical. We really do need to shut this bill down. Homeschool dads need to chime in on this. And the best way to do it is face-to-face with representatives that want to hear what you have to say. So, and that's what we've set up for you guys up there in Jefferson City, a contingent of representatives that want to hear your problems, what you have, issues with the bill, as particularly if you're, homeschool dad, and I think private schools, the fact that private schools haven't chimed in yet is very disturbing to me. I'm not sure a whole lot of private school people are even looking into this, but what else can anyone do, Kirby, at this point?
Well, and to add to the private schools, there were, I think, at least two that testified in favor of the bill in the hearing in the House. So
it's money.
Been snowed. I don't know. But yes, there was at least two that testified in favor of it. So I would recommend that you contact your representative and tell them that you're against this. If you need talking points, we can help provide those, but let them know that we want to be left out of, homeschoolers want to be left out of this bill. There's a lot of concern about this bill, but at the end of the day, if this goes wrong and private schools get taken over, we still have homeschooling if we can get us completely removed. Mm-hmm. But what we really need is for this bill to die.
Right. And so what Kirby, actually, I understand the sentiment of what Kirby said. What homeschoolers, and that includes homeschoolers in the initiative that have emailed me directly, mm-hmm. have said they don't care. They will pay their lump of flesh in property tax. They don't want the voucher. Mm-hmm. They just want the government to leave them alone in their homeschooling. And so is that what you're hearing a lot as well, Kirby?
Yes, that's exactly what I'm hearing from every homeschooler that I've spoken with. No one wants the money. We don't want the regulations. We don't want the risk of regulations. We just want to be left alone.
Yep, because that money comes with strings. And that's what the homeschoolers don't want, is those strings. They don't want data collection on their kids, along with the other bag of horrors that comes with this. And there's a lot of them, gang. This is a very big bill. If you want to look it up, if anyone wants to look it up, and if you're having problems finding SB 727, let me know, and I'll find it, and I'll drop a link for you. But this is something I think homeschool dads really, truly need to come together and talk to these reps. And these reps are there to listen to you. They definitely want to hear what you have to say. So this isn't a thing where they're going to turn you off and not listen to you. These reps specifically were selected because they definitely want to listen to the homeschoolers.
And we don't call on the dads often. So when we do, it's a big deal.
Yes, that's right. That's a good point, too. Misty says, if the private Mennonite community knew about this bill, they would not be happy. And I suspect you're right. Mennonites, you guys may want to consider going up to the Capitol for the homeschool dads meeting, too. And I've heard that there's contingent or two of Mennonites going up for this as well. Guys, this is about educational freedom. And that's what this is truly all about. It's not a school choice bill. It's a government choice bill. Mm-hmm. And that's where everyone got snowed. So, and even some senators didn't really know what they were voting on when they voted on it, because they didn't know the tricks that had been done in West Virginia and North Carolina with the two similar definitions between the PFEs and the homeschoolers, with the only differentiation being one takes vouchers and the other doesn't. Those were merged in other states. And so basically they were doing data collection on the homeschoolers, whether they took the money or not, after that got merged. So
There's been data collection going on, and they know that homeschooling is here to stay, that it's a large movement, and they're trying to destroy it. I guarantee you that's what they're trying to do, and bring it under state control. It just has to be said.
They can't control us. They can't control us, and we're the only ones they can't control.
Okay. Guitar Authority asked a very good question that was directly related to the statement that I made a little bit ago, so we can clarify. The question is, so if the homeschoolers don't take the money, will DESE have control over them or leave them alone? Currently, the way the bill is set up, if the homeschoolers don't take the money, then DESE and no one else will take control. They will be completely left alone. However, the what I told you guys about in West Virginia and now North Carolina, they did the same thing. They merged the two definitions, and then that's what happened, you know, after the fact. And then basically homeschoolers could not get out of the system anymore. They had to report to a centralized authority, and data collection began.
And it's incrementalism.
Yep.
So this right there, they're selling this because this doesn't do anything right now to traditional homeschoolers. It does not. That is correct. It's what's going to happen next. And if we're right and we get left in this bill, it goes south very fast. If we're wrong and we get left out of the bill, nothing happens. We still have one last bastion of freedom.
Yep. Okay. All right. Well, I'll tell you what. So once again, homeschool dads meeting, phone calling to your reps. I'm sorry. Did someone want to say something?
Yeah, I was going to say another thing, too, is, I mean, at the bare minimum, they should put a severability clause on it. That if it goes to court and that gets decided, then it biases towards the non-government funded homeschool, or it just eliminates the FPE section completely.
I think that's a great idea. Our other recommendation for a possibility was moving the FPE section under private schools. So instead of having it own section, to move it under the private school statute.
That's officers thinking there, Kirby. I didn't think about that.
Yeah, Caleb, we talked about
Caleb, I think that they're leaving that severability clause off for a reason, by the way.
Right.
Probably. Yeah.
So, but any rate, yeah, that's anyone, hang on, I'm going to check all the platforms here before we move on to the next part. We are getting some comments, but not questions. Oh, hang on. What are they doing as a government? They claim there is a problem and they offer the solution. The traditional mafia telling you that you need protection, break your shop window if you don't believe them. And you have to pay for protection, mafia or not. Okay, gotcha. And that's from Billions Should Check Out for Fake News and something on on Odyssey. Thank you very much for the comment. I appreciate it. Let's see. And, of course, we have people checking in. C.L. Moody, B. Hoffner, and Ozark's Freedom Gal. And so, and Jill King, is with us as well. So welcome to everybody. Let me make sure we don't have any other questions. Nope, no other questions. Okay, if there's any other relevant data that you think that people should know, Kirby?
No, I don't think so, but we are out of time, so just come if you can on Wednesday. I'll be there. I'm meeting with some other people that day as well outside of the homeschool dad, so if anybody wants to come there, I'll be there as well.
Okay.
Any of the women.
Okay, I have a question.
Go for it.
Do we have flyers? Do we have anything going on as far as that goes?
No, we just have, it's been word of mouth up until now. We kept very quiet about what we were doing because for a long time, we didn't want the other side to know. So.
Well, I started a sheet or whatever, and it's something you could email back and forth there and just get it perfected because of the knowledge that you have. Mm-hmm. I started one. So if you're interested, something to hand people if they want talking points or something to hand to the legislators, okay, so they can go down point by point, I think would be very helpful.
Okay. I appreciate that.
Okay.
Awesome.
Let's see. Kirby, do you have any documentation to the Carolina situation? I don't know if Kirby's looked into that. I was told that at the Prepared Homestead meeting. By someone who had just moved out of North Carolina for homeschool freedom. I mean, that's specifically what he said. So he was informed about this meeting coming up, but he didn't know the date and time. Hopefully he's on the email list and didn't have a Gmail account. So, because I've got a lot of guys, I mean, it's if you're on the email list, great. If you're not, I wouldn't know. I mean, it's just so big, and I don't go through it or anything. I just keep adding to it, actually. Guitar Authority says, since certain social benefits are beginning to be distributed by DESE connected to SNAP benefits, would the taking of SNAP benefits classify you as an FPE school since they are distributed by DESE?
I do not think so. I think you're only, I would have to go back and reread the way the statute is worded. Okay, so the way that the statute for FPE is worded is it may enroll children who participate in the program established in sections 135.712 to 135.719 and sections 166.700 to 166.720. So I would say that it's referring only to the Most Scholars program. So if you're taking the money from the Most Scholars program, then you would be required to have the regulations. But I would have to go back and read all of those sections to verify that it doesn't say anything about that in there.
Okay. Thank you for that. And by the way, if you're in the market for guitar strings, I get mine from Guitar Authority, by the way. I get nothing for saying that, by the way. But I wanted to make sure you guys knew. He comes up for Knock and Shock, so we advertise for him on our website. Free of charge, we get nothing for it. And thank you, Guitar Authority, for helping us keep Missouri free. Okay, gang, if you have any other questions, I'm not sure how long Kirby will stay with us, but we're going to move the conversation on. We're going to talk about silver and gold tonight, but after we hear from Retha and Gretchen talking about the school bonds that are not just in Missouri, nationwide, but we're going to talk about some new information that we have here in the state of Missouri, and also what you can do to investigate your school to find out if the bond is necessary or not, and actually start vetting the people running for school board in your district. So I'd like to turn it over to Gretchen and Retha now. And thank you very much, Kirby, by the way.
Thank you for having me.
You bet.
Go ahead, Gretchen.
Well, you know, I don't have too much other than that I was messing around on the MASA website today, and they have a whole lot of information about how to invest the money that they get from the taxpayer. I also found a very interesting presentation that they give to it's an actual presentation template that they give to school districts on how to sell bonds and even levies and all kinds of stuff. They get all kinds of help, information, and training on how to sell bonds to your local community. It's very, very well organized.
Well, I'll tell you what, one of the things that you came up with, I actually did a short video on. So Gretchen, you know, did some quick, you know, just a cursory search, actually, and found out that, you know, the company that's actually providing the finances for Owensville, if their bond goes through, is actually a partner with the WEF. And I think maybe that's something that we should actually kind of talk about. That's an aspect we never really thought of before this past week. But I think it bears scrutiny at this point, and maybe we can start peeling this onion, getting to some lower layers here.
I would not be one bit surprised if ultimately they were also involved in what's going on with the education bill.
Yes. You know, it's all connected, isn't it? In fact,
it's all connected. It's all there. What the World Economic Forum and UNESCO, what DESE says, what the NGOs like MSBA and the MASA, it's all the exact same purpose, the exact same wording in many cases, mm-hmm. exact same intent. And yeah. So this, the takeover from that they're trying to do with this education bill is, it's frightening.
Yep. Well, Stifle is the name of the company that is directly linked to the WEF and Klaus Schwab. I want to talk about another one that's not so direct. And that's one actually, Raymond James, and that's what Clever, that's the company Clever Missouri uses. That's my hometown. That is my school district. And the Raymond James itself is not partnered with the World Economic Forum, but the CEO of Raymond James is affiliated directly with the World Economic Forum. In fact, there's even a page for him. And so,
yeah, Paul C. Riley.
Yep, Paul C. Riley. Thank you. And it's, I don't know. I just find this really, really strange because basically there's an agenda, you know, that's coming forth from the WEF. And how many of us actually understand, you know, basically the intricacies of actually getting that agenda through a bond contract? Have we read the contracts? Do we know the contracts? Do we know if there are strings attached to this money? That they may have to accept some DEI or something of that nature in order to take the bond, that they have to have a certain.
Oh, I think they let the government do that. They the government arm of this fascist type of, you know, system that we have going, you will have DESE and FedGov and then down to DESE come in with all those types of things. I suspect the financial arm, this is just me, I haven't seen any financial things, but to me it's just they're making money like parasites off of us.
Yes, they are. It's a money-making operation for them through and through. Anyone who thinks that these companies are here actually, you know, to provide the best education for your kids are sorely mistaken. That's not what they're there for. They're there to make money, and as much money as possible, by the way. So, and that's just a fact.
It's about the Benjamins.
Yep, it is.
Mm-hmm.
So,
so much that's being implemented is indirectly through people that run these companies, like Bureau Behavioral Center that we have here in the Springfield area. Their chair, well, actually, they're associated with CARF, and then it's a rehabilitation facility accreditation organization, mm-hmm. and they're partnered with Bureau Behavioral Health, and Susan Breyer is the chair and current member of the board of that organization. So if they're not directly linked, they're indirectly linked. And these Bureau Behavioral Centers are getting more and more influence in the schools. They're increasing their contracts and everything else with the schools. It's become, of course, a multi-million dollar industry that alone for these places. Mm-hmm. So
I found on the MASA website, they linked to the Missouri Commissioner's Education Policy Committee, which had made some recommendations. This is back from 2019, okay? And the whole thing is building the workforce through early childhood education. What are they pushing now? Here we are 5 years later. What are they pushing in all the school districts? Early childhood education centers in there. The amount of state control that this advisory committee recommendation, I'll put a link down in the thing for it. This is lockstep with groups like World Economic Forum, lockstep with MASA, MSBA, and all the other little organizations that they are affiliated with. And it's complete taking over of education to the point that, and they talk about teachers in this little thing, it's only about a 7-page thing, but workforce development, they actually, I just have to read this one thing, you can't believe it. It's, Missouri needs to develop a shared vision defining the role of early childhood education, particularly as it relates to strengthening the current and future workforce. Okay, we're talking early childhood education. Why are they talking about strengthening the current and future workforce? It's just pure evil.
Sounds like they want kids climbing up for bowls of millet after a day of work in the mine when they're 7 years old. That's what it sounds like.
I would not be a bit surprised because, they think of us as cattle. So. Yep.
Okay, can I ask you guys I'm sorry, go ahead, Retha.
Go ahead. And that's just it, that this early childhood development, that's basically daycare. And so think about that. You're getting they're getting these kids. It's already, pre-K is 3 and 4 year olds. So this is all they'll ever know, is being in this institution. You might want to think about that. And all this space that the schools are trying to create, you have to actually start to question, is some of the space putting in these early developmental centers, in other words, daycares, and start grooming them for the workforce, as she said, and without our knowledge, consent, or awareness. So
just wait till you get to, and this same advisory committee recommendations, they have a whole big thing on data collection, using data systems. I can't believe they are really saying the quiet part out loud. And again, like I said, I will link to this. The amount of data that's being collected, and that's another thing about MASA. MASA does a yearly survey of school districts, by the way. I think I sent you a link, Retha. And this gives them a huge amount of data with which to formulate what they want to do next, based on what the different school districts are saying. and then they formulate what they're going to do, plan it out, and then execute on it. And school people do not understand the dangers of the kind of data collection that is being done on all of us. The school, I guarantee you, the superintendents and the school districts have no idea how this is being, this kind of stuff is being used in order to drive them too.
Yeah, the class wallets, social credit scoring. I mean, all this stuff applies, doesn't it?
All of it. And they, data to them is gold, because they can then, they can turn, you know, remember that my big fat Greek wedding, the husband may be the head, but the woman is the neck, and she can turn the head any way she wants. That's what they're doing. They're turning us any direction they want through their data collection, and then they formulate their policies, yep, their plans, and the execution of it.
Yep. It sounds like it. And once again, we've dealt with this before, you know, with, and this was in the House of Representatives, Dean Plocker was trying to get in some software called Fireside, and that was data collection too. And it was constituency management, and we didn't know where the data would be housed. But, you know, honest to God, it was the same type of system. So people, keep in mind, in this day and age right now, information is money. It's currency. A lot of people want to deal in information. And getting information on your kids is extremely valuable to certain corporations and to government as well. So it's just a new way for them to make money off of your kids, off of their data. And so I'm not even going to get into the types of data. It's not just grades. It's more than that. For instance, if you have, and I hate to interrupt you, gals, but this is important. If you have a situation where they're bringing in some kind of psychologist to your school, you know, like Burrell is looking to do here in the southwest of Missouri, then basically they'll get their information, get information from that as well. And of course, parents aren't there while these counselors are talking to your kids. So, you know, once again, that's extremely valuable data. And they could actually, and I hate to talk about this because this gets into where people say conspiracy theory, get into the neighborhood of literally taking your kids away. And I know that people say that's a conspiracy theory. Look no further than, you know, the system we have here in Missouri. You know, basically when kids get taken away all the time by social services for sometimes the dumbest reasons. But at any rate, it is something to be concerned about. But I'll tell you what, I'm going to direct us back here real quick here. First of all, school bonds. We have a lot of them going on nationwide and, of course, in Missouri as well. And for those who have not been able to investigate their own districts for school bonds, do you guys have any advice for them on what they can do quickly before Tuesday to investigate their own school bonds? Or would you, like, for instance, this is what I tell people all the time. If I'm in your district and I'm a voter and I know nothing about the school debt, I know nothing about the school finance, I'm going to vote no. Now, I don't tell people how to vote, but that's how I would vote. Would you guys say that's pretty much what you guys would recommend as well?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, if you, the very first thing that you could is just go to your county or city website and look up what the ballot language says. Sometimes it'll be on the school website, but it'd probably be easier to find on your municipal website. If there is, look at the ballot language. If it has a couple phrases, maybe Retha can share, you're going to know that they're deceiving you.
Okay. How about
yeah,
this
it's
one?
That language of S. Go ahead.
I was going to, no, if you had a further comment, you do it, Retha.
That estimated to remain unchanged.
Oh, yeah, the bond.
That is language. That is terrible language, because estimated total levy that you, portion that you pay to the schools when you look at your taxes and you have bonds, well, that's lumped all together. When they put estimated to remain unchanged, it, that portion that you pay for those bonds can go up. In other words, you can get tax increases. If they aren't receiving enough revenue that's estimated the estimated increases, then they're going to raise your taxes. It happened here in Clever. We had like a 15-cent increase 1 year. The 1 year we had a small decrease in revenue, raised it 15 cents, and we've been paying it ever since. So it's very dangerous language.
Yep.
It should be to remain unchanged, not estimated to remain unchanged. So I'm seeing this in a lot of language, and I've seen this where they ask for an increase in, say, their operations. They'll use that, you know, expected, you know, and that's another one. It's still that same loophole in language. It's expected. Well, it wasn't what we expected. Yeah. And then it's going to be at a higher rate. I've seen that too. So when you start looking at this ballot language, you go, well, that's terrible language, because now we're in a contract and they can increase our taxes, you know, when they aren't getting the expected revenue. And then also to remain on no tax increase. Well, there's no such thing as a free lunch. No, that just extends a levy you've already been paying, an extra tax you've already been paying. So, and people always ask, well, how long is that going to extend it? Well, it's going to extend it 20 years. These are 20-year bonds. So you're looking at, you know, you may pay it down a little bit sooner, you may not, but you're still looking at probably anywhere from 18 to 20 years. So,
okay, let me ask you
another question. This debt's going to last a while.
Let me ask you another question here, real quick. So, what about school? You know, just talking about the school board, there's a lot of people running for school board on the same ballot on this coming up Tuesday. And in fact, I'm going to ask you, I forgot to mention Sam is with us tonight. There's no visual representation or avatar. He's coming through on my cell phone. And Sam recently went through something where school board members were, you know, basically allowed to come and talk to the community and, you know, give their ideas of what they would, you know, would like to see and do. But what about knowing your school board's members and then also those who are running for that office currently? If you don't know, you know, what can you do to find out? And I'll actually leave it up to you guys. I'm actually going to mute myself here real quick because my dogs here are just whining and whining. I'm going to take them outside here real quick. But I'll be right back. But you guys can carry on that discussion. And we will get to silver and gold, by the way. For those of you hanging in there, we will get to silver and gold soon. But please, let's talk about election of school board members, what we should look for, what makes a good school board member. And also, what are reasons to actually vote people out of school board? And I think with between Sam and Gretchen and Retha, I think we can have quite a conversation on that. So you go ahead.
Sam, start it out. You've got a lot of experience there.
Yeah, I can go ahead and pick this up if you want me to. I was at, we had what was called Meet the Candidates meeting Thursday evening here in Owensville. And every one of these school board members are all into the same thing. They want to push the school bond and the agenda. There was one guy who was somewhat hesitant, but he said he could change his mind depending upon what happened if he was elected. So he's a little bit wishy-washy. I'd like to get a hold of him and talk to him about it. But the people that were down there at, you know, promoting this whole thing, absolutely were totally out to lunch on just about everything. I mean, basically these people were just running totally on emotion. And I'm running into a lot of them people around here. Well, John Adams, who is with John Adams Real Estate here, he was supposed to speak, but I think he kind of made one fatal mistake, and that was he got on social media. And of course, you know how people are on social media. They will attack people in ways that they won't attack people in person. Well, he got on there and he said, I'm not going to argue with any of you up here. He said, I'm not going to argue on social media. If you want to talk to me, you come to my office and talk to me face to face. Well, you see how far that went. Most of them people, keyboard warriors, they are they're absolutely useless, except to just sit there and do ad hominem attacks, you know, on you know, through their keyboards. So that's one problem. I ran into a problem though when I got up to speak. There was one gentleman there who was an absolute flaming Democrat, and he bought the whole agenda. And when I started addressing the whole issue of the school bond and the taxation, and the start getting into the issue with the economy, because contrary to what he said, the economy does have something to do with it. He tried to fire back at me that he didn't come to get an economics lesson. I felt like saying, well, you're going to get one anyway. And you know, what I really should have said to him, I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to everybody else, you know, because I've had run-ins with this guy before. So he's no, you know, he's no stranger when it comes to dealing with him. I mean, this is a guy, to give you an idea, that believes that our police department should have all electric police cars. And, you know, and of course, none of our policemen are having it here. So, you know, but still, just the idea to give you where this guy is. So anyway, he absolutely kept trying to disrupt my conversation. But what was interesting and typical style of the way these people operate, he started attacking me, and then in his conversation with the guy who was moderating the meeting, said, and by the way, he doesn't need to comment, you know, kind of like signaling to cut the mic off. Well, much to the credit of the gentleman who was moderating the meeting that night, he did not cut the mic off. So I was able to pretty much blast back and say what I had to say. And, you know, and I just stood up to him. I'm tired of this, you know, these people. Then I had another gal that came into a restaurant yesterday where we were. She was sitting there eating, and some of us were just having a leisure conversation about it. And all of a sudden she got up and she was so hateful, and she was trying to use the excuse that her son got killed and all this kind of stuff, which that's true. But the point of the matter is, you may be grieving over your son, but that is going to give you a right to attack everybody else in the restaurant. And so I just kept, you know, going, you know, back and saying, if you're going to be hateful, you're just losing all your credibility with us. And she slammed her silverware down and walked out. I mean, this is the kind of stuff we're getting from these people. These are basket cases. This gal used to be a teacher at the school. A lot of these people are just basket cases, and they don't operate on an intellectual playing field the way that we all do here, where we all can discuss things intelligently. So that's been my experience just in this week.
Well, that's just right. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
That's the problem. They're leading with emotional sentiment. And it's like, okay, well, when you're in an emotional state, how logical are you? How, you know, are you going to be able to see through and navigate the waters if you're all up in emotion? And yes, I'm seeing this online like nobody's business. It's for the children, and they deserve the best, and. Well, wait a minute now. We're not saying that they don't deserve to have, a nice school. But the problem is if you're just looking at the kids, you're not looking at the responsibility of the school district to be fiscally responsible. That's why I'm like, it's the financial aspect of this. People don't want to learn how they're supposed to be fiscally responsible, how those accounts work, and how much more revenue that they're getting, and how much revenue they have been getting. And it's like, well, they had a responsibility to those funds, and they don't want to hear that. Well, no, the school has had these funds. Their school is not getting repaired because they're not using these funds. And yes, and that they want to make those earnings on temporary deposits. Remember what you were talking about earlier, where they can invest. Well, that way, that's just a slush fund for them, right? You know, well, we want to keep, you know, this money in there so we can make these earnings on temporary deposits. But that those some of those funds are supposed to be for those repairs. Part of that operations levy, they have a schedule that they should be meeting. They know when they need certain things. Like Gasconade R2 has, you know, more than the baseline levy. They have more than just the baseline. And then they've also been getting the increase in revenue from either new construction or, you know, increase in property values. So they're getting all the, they're getting extra money. And they're not using the funds that is supposed to be for these repairs in their account. They're, people think these bonds are for maintenance. No, they are not. They're supposed to be for new construction, for increased growth in students, or repairs beyond budget where you got a school collapsing. Yep. You know, you need to replace it or something like that. And that, you know, that should be what, once every 100, 150 years, maybe 200, depending on how well the building was built. So it, you shouldn't be seeing bonds every 2 to 3 years. I mean, this has just gotten insane.
It's out of control, Retha. You're so right.
You should not be seeing this. This is not normal, folks. You know, something right. happened after the shutdown. People's brains shut off. They should realize this is not natural. We shouldn't be seeing these in this kind of frequency.
Well, and let's turn it just a little bit back to how we should choose our candidates. I found out today that Scott Price, who is, he's the Springfield public schools candidate. He's already on the board. He's looking for another term. He is the Springfield representative of the regional, he's regional executive committee chair, Springfield representative of the Missouri School Boards Association. Okay. So there is a connection with one of those NGO trade organizations that is helping our federal and state governments to implement policies like DEI, SEL, trauma-based education, and of course, Patty Quisenberry, the famous Patty in the Ozark School District, who is the president-elect of the MSBA and has been serving on the school board for 27 years. It is no wonder that DEI, SEL, and all these things are being implemented on the local level, because you have candidates like them who are closely associated with these state trade organizations. Very incestuous.
Yep. I'd like to read a few comments here real quick, based on what you guys are saying. Maria 28 says, no intellect, and yet they are teachers? Yikes. Misty says, don't forget that the schools are using SEL, social and emotional learning. It isn't rational learning, but teaching from an emotional reaction learning style. This is dangerous, folks. You don't want to make decisions out of fear or panic, or, you know, you've got to use critical thinking in your processing. And SEL denies you this. They say they want to, well, we teach critical thinking skills in our school. No, they don't. No, they don't. Ask them to define it. Next time a teacher tells you that, ask them to define what critical thinking is.
I got a definition.
Go ahead.
Critical of independent thought.
Yep, that's pretty much it. Maria says, the fruits of wokeness. And Guitar Authority says, my local schools are crying victim that they only have the minimum tax being collected by law, and now they're victims. They actually published this. So, and I think that's consistent with many schools across the board. Guys, there is a reason why, and I hate to interrupt you gals here, but there's a reason why nationally there's a lot of school districts going for maximum bond capacity. They're all doing it at this, and not all of them are doing it, by the way, as Owensville, you know, the people there love to, people associated with the schools love to tout. We could go for 27 million, but we're not monsters. We only want 16.5 million. And that's enough for me. I mean, honest to God, they did at one point go for maximum, and that was like 20 million or something. But once again, that had to do with that shell game.
Well, it's 20 million at the current levy.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, if they went for 27 million, they would have to raise that levy. They would have to raise it to actually probably close to what ours is for our bond, which would be definitely over a dollar.
Yep.
Able to not only pay off what they have, but to be able to do this, you know, for 20 years, because the interest alone in the first few years of that is going to be, you know, over $600,000.
Hey, Retha, I'm not sure if it's the interest on the one bond. You're getting hard to hear.
The interest on that bond alone, just that one, is going to be over $600,000 for the first, you know, probably 3 years.
Okay.
That, somewhere in there.
Okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, actually, that may be on my end.
So
there we go. I fixed it. It was on my end. Sorry about that, Retha.
Okay. Yeah, people are coming from an emotional standpoint, and this is exactly what they're teaching in schools. You go from an emotional standpoint. And I'm just like, look, you know, this is going to be your kid's debt.
Yep.
And if you're okay with that, okay. You know.
Well, I'll tell you what, anyone who's listening in on any of the social media platforms we're streaming on right now, now's your chance. We've got Gretchen here, we've got Retha here, and we even have Kirby here. If you guys have any questions, you know, basically about school bonds, basically people running for school board in your local district, or SB 727, the homeschooler killer bill. Thank you once again, Senator Koenig, for visiting that monstrosity on us. If you guys have any questions, please put them in the socials that you're in. I'm monitoring all of them, including Twitter. So if you guys have
Patrick,
if you're looking for a new school board member, you got to have some of them that are willing to be in the financial aspect of that. That's going to hold them accountable. That's what we're lacking. Everybody's got an agenda. When they go into that, oh, I want to increase the sports program or this or that. And they don't look at the accountability to the community. That's what I look for. You know, that's what you got to have, that balance in there. If you don't, well, then you're going to see bonds till all the time, constant bonds, you know.
Okay. Hey, 1 second. Sam, did you have a question?
Yeah, no, I was just going to make one final comment on this whole thing.
Sure.
The one thing I want to mention is that the only ones who had a problem with the stuff I was talking about was the school board and this one guy I was talking about a while ago. After the meeting was over, I had a lot of people come up and thank me for my speech. So We got a lot of people out here who are sick to death of, and a lot of them elderly. They know what's coming. They know that... if they get away with constantly doing this, they know that eventually the taxes will get so out of control that they could wind up losing their homes, and they know it, and they thank me for speaking up. So there was a positive in that meeting, too, so I just want to make sure everybody knew that there was some positives out of that, too.
Thank you for sharing that. And, in fact, I listened to the entire thing that you had recorded at that meeting. And, you know, what Retha had said earlier, there's a lot of people that are dealing with school issues based on purely on emotion. That's it. Do it for the kids. The kids need this. I mean, the kids need, this performing arts center. They need, you know, the new AstroTurf on the football field. They have to have it. I mean, if they don't have it, you know, basically they're going to feel bad because the next door neighbor school, you know, does have new AstroTurf, does have, you know, a new performing arts center. I mean, this is the silly kind of stuff we're hearing from them. And they say the kids need this to compete in the real world. We're talking about curriculum, and we haven't even gotten to grades yet. And if we go to grades, all we're going to do is depress people. Unfortunately, I've said this in private conversations before. I don't say this publicly, but we're churning out a lot of kids right now that aren't as smart as they could be. The education system has completely failed. The public education system in Missouri is a disaster. It is in many states, by the way. We're not alone. But how is it that we can consistently keep lowering testing scores over a period of 40 years in America, whereas in 1982 we were number one in the world and now we're number 27? And we spend an enormous amount of money on education. And countries that are passing us up are third world, some of them are third world nations that spend a tiny fraction. So is it really that we're not spending enough money on the kids? We're not putting enough, you know, brand new AstroTurf in. We're not putting enough, theaters or whatever you want to call them, performing arts centers, you know, that we, you know, we need repairs done and we don't have it in the levy. So we need to tax people more for repairs. We're going to buy stuff in with internal debt, and then we're going to borrow money, you know, with the people's vote to pay off our internal debt so we can wipe our slate clean. Like Gretchen so awesomely put in her blog, the schools don't have to tighten their belts if you vote yes on these bonds. But I'll tell you what.
Yeah, you know, Retha gave me that line.
Yep, but it's absolutely correct. We have to tighten our belts. But you're supposed to do it for the kids to the point where you're kicking the elderly out of their homes in your school district. That's what they want. And that, for some reason, is acceptable behavior to some of these folks. It's okay to kick elderly people out of their home. They're at the end of their lives. We need to worry about the kids. We need to get AstroTurf there. We need to get the new Performing Arts Center. You know, it's weird. It's just weird to me.
Parents, yes, it's very weird because I think it's a long-term brainwashing operation where it's for the children. It's for on and on and on. Parents who sometimes, in quiet moments may admit that the schools have completely dumbed down, not only them, because parents nowadays have been in this indoctrination system for a while, but their intellect is divorced from their feelings, and it's much easier to just go with your feelings than it is to go, why are our school scores in the 38th percentile?
Yep.
For English? Why are we getting a D or an F in language arts and math? And yet still they want to vote for yet more, you know, whether it's a classroom or a weight room or whatever it is, they don't seem to make connections. They're lacking the connection there. I look at it and I think it's really, you have to get past the emotional indoctrination of it's for the children.
Yeah. And
we got another problem going on too, is that here you have these smaller districts that don't have kind of revenue, say, you know, like a city or a larger town has, where they have industry, a lot of business and things like that. And you got these smaller communities trying to compete with these larger towns with more money. And it's like, do you not understand that revenue has to come from somewhere? And if you don't have the financial infrastructure to support it, you can't have it. And if you try, well, then eventually you're going to actually be a ghost town because nobody's going to be able to afford to live there. The businesses will move out and the people will move out. And I've seen this actually up in your favorite person's territory up in the northwest part of the state. I keep always forget her name. Piper. Jess Piper.
Yes, Piper.
I was looking at the school districts up there and their levies, and then, you know, you hear that, well, these towns are turning into ghost towns. And I'm like, well, I can't imagine why. They're paying a lot in school tax just on their operations line. And I'm going, well, you get what you get.
Yep. And Missouri Education's chiming in. She says, well, the testing is based on the MAP test. The schools can't see the MAP test. No denial that education is dumbed down, but the MAP test is proprietary and no one can see the test before or after it is taken. Not the parent, not the teacher. And in fact, I'll do you one better, Missouri Education. Maybe I shouldn't say the school district I heard this at, but there is a school district somewhere in Southwest Missouri where they're allowed to take the MAP test a second time if they don't score of a good grade. They'll take, and then they'll let them take the better of the two. In that instance, they do, the school does see the MAP test. And I will have to talk to you privately. I'll let you know what school it is. So at any rate, but yes, I agree with you. It's a junk test. But the issue here remains, are we about curriculum or are we about AstroTurf? I mean, at what point do we give up our homes and have the government take our homes away from us at gunpoint so the kids can have AstroTurf and performing arts centers? At what point do we say enough is enough when we see elderly people that have worked their entire lives, that are enjoying their retirement, kicked out of their homes because they, you know, they need to do it for the kids? We need to vote in higher taxes for the kids. Let's not take into account elderly folks in our school district as well as people on fixed incomes. That doesn't even compute for some of these people. It's really quite sad, especially when it comes to how bad the grades are. Now, if
you know,
go ahead.
You know, when I was in Owensville, that Carrie, who's running for school board there, she's a teacher. I think she's involved with the MSTA too. Somebody asked her that question. What, you know, what would you do to make sure the kids, you know, have everything or whatever? And she said, I would do anything. I would do anything for the children.
Yep.
And the insanity of that statement, when you think about it, and I think it was in reference to people losing their homes. It was actually into the elderly losing their homes and being taxed out of their homes. And she said she would do anything. Of course, she's 30-something years old.
Yep. And, you know, once again,
Go
ahead, Caleb.
I absolutely cannot stand that type of person, and they're everywhere.
Yep.
They're the same. Most of them are the same people that, if they're the vegan ones as well, they will look at you and say, well, if you're going to buy meat, buy it, or, you know, buy it from the store rather than going and killing an animal. I'm like, most of them are just that stupid.
Yeah.
I have debated with these people online before, the same type, and they will look right at you and they say, well, if they can't afford the taxes, maybe they shouldn't own it.
Yep. I hear that too, by the way. That is a common mantra from a lot of folks that are, you know, involved with the public school system. I've heard before and actually seen on Twitter before, people say, well, if you can't afford the taxes, you should move out of the district. Go live someplace where, you know, they have crappy schools. I've actually seen that before on Twitter, too. What they don't understand is the public schools everywhere are crappy. America's public education system is literally in the sewer now. We can't even compete with third world nations like India anymore. And we're throwing money hand over fist at these schools. It's not about the education anymore. It's about what we refer to as the Prussian school model. It's about actually turning kids into workers, not thinkers. You know, that's what the Prussian model is all about. So that's something that I think a lot of people need to take into account when it comes to, you know, a lot of these school bond issues. Does what your school, what they're asking for right now, is it truly worth it? Is it truly worth another 20 years of debt for people on low or fixed incomes or retired folks? Is it really worth it? Is that AstroTurf really worth kicking, you know, people out of their homes? Is it really worth, and then once again, I have to come back to the grades. In our school district, the Clever, the grades are so bad. So bad. I can't even describe it. Gretchen has a printout. Gretchen, did you put that in your blog? I think you did.
I did. Let me check on it and see if I can find it here. Real quick. It's pretty shocking, quite frankly.
Yep.
I mean, our school district had mostly D's with a C or two. It had an F. The one A it had was that they managed to graduate, you know, 97% of their students. Mm-hmm. And my computer doesn't want to work right now. Hold on. I don't have my phone on me, so.
Patrick?
Oh, there it goes.
Yes, I'm here, Sam.
Okay.
Yeah, I just had a real quick comment. As I was talking to Gretchen the other day, and I've talked to several other people since, I said, you know, you can kind of see why people just get aggravated and they buy RVs and they just become nomads, where they just, they don't have any particular jurisdiction where they stay. They just go wherever. And that way, if they run into, you know, stuff like what we're running into here, they don't have to pack up because it's already packed up. They can just take off.
Yep. That's right. I got to read a couple of things here real quick. Missouri Education's putting in some interesting information. But she is asking who is rating A through F, and I happen to know that's the Show Me Institute. So I can answer that question.
And the Show Me Institute is not, they're not really super conservative. And so I can drop a link in the Gilded, and you can share that out. But for instance, in our English language arts, all students get a grade D in English language. By grade, they get Ds. Gross score, a C. All students adjusted, an F on proficiency or higher. I mean, it's unbelievably. Math, they're a little bit better, Cs. But I mean, you're looking at education levels that would have been unheard of, lowest scores that would have been unheard of a generation or two ago, even though they've been going down steadily. And Clever is around 300, and I have to look at it again. It's 300 and something out, 316 out of 535 school districts. That's what they're ranked. And yet, they have a 15 student to one teacher ratio. Okay. That's beautiful. That's, you know, when I went to school, we had 30 or 31 kids in a class. Okay. And that was not the kind of scores they would have died rather than let their kids have scores like that. And believe me, Desi helps them hide scores by, you know, the stats and all that kind of stuff they do. They mess with it so that it doesn't, you know, make them look like they're absolutely failing when they really are absolutely failing. In fact, I would say a majority of schools in the state are absolutely failing.
Yep. And it's happening in other states too, gang. Don't think that Missouri's alone in this and that something's wrong with Missouri, but the rest of the country's doing great. That is not the case. Just fair warning. Actually, I want to read a comment from Sam I Am. Sam I Am says, I've lived and worked more than half my life in some of these third world countries, and they run circles around our education system. And actually, Sam, I already knew that, but it's good to hear someone else say that too, because a lot of people ask me to produce evidence of this. Then I have to go searching online and find all the documentation again. And then I send it to them, and this is usually Democrats on Twitter. I send it to them, and they say, that's not a reliable source. Well, how about this one? No, that's not a reliable source either. Mm-hmm. And so I just have stopped providing evidence to Democrats now. Source, please. I give them sources, and then for some reason it's not acceptable.
My usual response, along with a lot of others, particularly on Twitter, is just replying with that, bucktooth basement dwelling fat guy with the glasses screaming sources.
Yep.
It's a meme. That's really all they ever deserve.
Yep. And Missouri Education says that basically Show Me Institute has some weird stats. I'd be careful using their data. Student to teacher ratio is wrong. They are using all staff to student, including admins. So that's what they include in their student to teacher ratio, apparently. We're just looking
I'm
at
not
the
sure.
Desi.
I
that is from
that
Desi.
Desi. Yep. That stat of the 50. Desi.
Yep. I knew that. So, all right. So if anyone has any more questions, Tuesday's coming up real quick, gang. If you don't know what to do, please chime in, ask. You've got the experts in right now. If you don't know what to do with the school bond in your area, or you don't know what to do with voting for, you know, for instance, someone who's running for school board, please ask your questions now. And basically we'll get those to the experts that are with us. Missouri Education says DESE is junk too. Actually, if DESE's junk and show me and show me as junk, I mean, where would you go to get the information, Missouri Education? Because that's all we have to go on. Cheryl is saying Carrie worked for the school and then was a principal 1 year in a neighboring score and now works for Missouri State Teachers Association, MSTA, is what Cheryl is chiming in on Odyssey. So, I'm looking at all of our...
But she didn't know that they carry insurance?
Yeah, she didn't know they carry insurance. That's right.
That did. She was shocked, wasn't she?
She was. So that's why schools hold back a ton of money when they have bonds out, is to, you know, for a rainy day or, you know, an emergency. So she didn't realize.
Natural disasters. That's natural disaster.
There we go. Let's see. Missouri Education says, I appreciate you all looking into this. Okay. All right, gang. Well, if that's all if we're going to still go on a little bit longer. If you guys have questions about bonds, about people running for school board, throw them in the chats. I will keep monitoring. But I think it's time to move to gold and silver now. So, hang on, Missouri Education. Good question, LOL. For example, my school is kindergarten 16-1, and they say it's 13-1 on DESE. So, okay, gotcha. So they've obviously thrown another person in there that throws off all the numbers for all the classes. I gotcha.
Well, I mean, they use different criteria. All these different organizations will use different criteria. And so some of it's going to be off a little bit. Again, nothing is perfect, right? We live in a fallen world. So.
That's right. And I want to say for the record, before we move on to gold and silver, we love kids. We love teachers. We love our local schools. But they're failing the kids. And you don't reward them with money for, you know, AstroTurf and for, you know, performing arts centers. You don't do that. You have to let them know you're very disappointed in the kids' curriculum testing scores. And that's what they're there in school for. They're not there for football. They're not there for choir and band. They're there literally to learn. So some will say, well, choir and band and football, you know, is all about team effort and learning how to work with other people and this and that and the other thing. I'm telling you, third world nations don't have this, and they're outperforming our kids in science and in math all day long. You know,
and they go like half days.
Yeah,
they go like half days.
That's right. Retha's right, actually. Yeah, they have like 4 hour days in these classes. You know, in third world nations, and they're just zooming past our kids in science and math. Think about this for a second. They say they're preparing the kids for the future, right? Well, who do you think, you know, that job is going to want to hire? You know, basically someone who got D's in science, you know, to be a biochemist? Or are they going to hire that guy from India that got straight A's? You know, who are they going to want to hire? We have got to stop thinking about this emotionally and thinking about this, you know, intellectually. Who would you want?
Well, the other thing is, too, it's all workforce. They talk about workforce, you know, implementation and preparing workers. They're purposely dumbing us down.
Yes.
And preparing us for work that is for the Eloi.
That's right.
That's what they're doing. It's so obvious. And people better wake up quick.
Yep. Agreed. And I, you know, honest to God, I don't know how some people can justify some of the things they say about, you know, basically we have to do this for the kids. We're actually failing our kids. And that's a fact. Mm-hmm. And the entire public school apparatus, the entire infrastructure is failing our kids. This is about money, folks. This is about money. Mm-hmm. I know people who say, the whole religion system has failed because, you know, it's all about money. And you know what? I get it to a certain extent. I definitely get that. Why don't they admit it that it's the same for the public schools? It's all about money, gang. And so
because of the emotional connection they have with the teachers,
yep,
and everything else. That's what it is. It's that emotional connection. Mm-hmm. And they have their kids for 8 hours a day, and they entrust them to keep them safe and to educate them. Mm-hmm. It's that connection. They don't realize that there's somebody behind the curtain that has a different agenda.
Right.
You know,
they have emotional connections. The connections in the background. That's what they're missing, the connections for why schools have become big business, why trade organizations and other lending, predatory lenders and stuff are, you know, they're like a fat tick on the taxpayer in order to just produce more and more revenue for themselves, to enrich themselves.
Yep. And, you know, that's where the Chamber of Commerce comes in. That's MSBA, which is, of course, you know, a private organization, the NEA, private organization. People say, oh, government schools are great. You guys don't understand who's actually running the curriculum in those government schools, and that's private companies. And so, and they're very
Comes down from federal. Well, some of that comes from federal because, you know, they get federal funds. You know, so some of that curriculum is based on that too.
At this point, this is how they're working. So they're working the federal, you know, who knows what trade organization or what person in the federal government came up with the latest SEL or DEI, but they work hand in glove. They're together. Yep. They're like this. And they probably cross implement and cross, you know, pollinate everything they are doing. It's very fascist.
Yep. Very well said, Gretchen. It's fascism. That's what it is. So, and yes, this is not hatred towards the public schools. It's hatred towards the control of the public schools, which is the very thing Kirby was talking about tonight with that bill. They want to control homeschoolers now too. So, and that's why SB 727 is so dangerous. Okay, gang, I think we'll go ahead and any questions you guys throw in, we will get to. I will monitor that. We're going to get to silver and gold now, but I'm going to start with Lion Up 3, who is chiming in on Rumble. So Lion Up 3 apparently lives in Louisiana and says, Louisiana rhinos vote no on our transactional precious metals bill. So we're talking about the legal tender bill in Louisiana, 16-2, and it's HB 714. So that's their bill in Louisiana. I am very sorry to hear that. That is terrible. That is really, really bad because it won't cost the state anything to do that. Nothing. So they've just taken away, or I'm sorry, not taken away, but they have reaffirmed that they're willing to break their oaths to the Constitution of the United States. Article 1, Section 10 says, that gold and silver are money. And it looks like the rhinos in your state are not willing to actually acknowledge that. They have now broken their oaths. So apparently lineup says couldn't get it out of committee. Okay. Well, let me tell you where we're at here, gang. And I'll tell you, you know, to the best of my ability, and I don't have all the data in front of me, but gold and silver is really heating up in Missouri right now, really heating up in the Senate. We'll start there. Senator Igel's, SB 735 is actually going to be going on the floor, possibly Tuesday or Wednesday of this week. So finally, his bill is moving. If you guys remember, because he's in the Freedom Caucus and because he was actually filibustering in the Senate, he didn't break any rules. But, of course, Caleb Rowden, the Senate pro tem, decided to punish him and three others by taking away their chairmanships and also their parking spaces at the Capitol. Because that has never happened before to sitting chairmen, they didn't have a process to figure out what to do with bills that have cleared the committee, were signed off by a chairman who is no longer the chairman of the committee. And apparently it took him about 6-7 weeks to figure out what to do because now it's going on the floor. So that's what's happening on that side. Now let's talk about the House. Well, actually, no, we need to talk about one more thing in the Senate. This is pretty exciting. So Senator Crawford has a bill, and it's SB 835, and that's a banking bill. And apparently it was extremely appropriate to attach the gold and silver bill or amend the gold and silver bill to that banking bill. So we have another way for gold and silver to get out of the system, actually make it through the system on a bill that has a lot of amendments. This is what we refer to as a Christmas tree. But with the Plocker rules, I don't want to get very technical. With the Plocker rules, it's pretty much guaranteed that anything that gets out is going to have to pretty much be a Christmas tree. So the Senate recognizes that, so they went ahead and made sure that silver and gold would actually be on a big Senate bill that has banking bills on it. So hopefully that makes its way out. That's still got to go through the House, though. Okay, now let's go to the House. In the House, we have HB 1955, and that's been stuck in committee for over 2 months now. And so it did have a committee hearing, but it never had an executive session. They never voted it out of committee. And he's been Chairman Michael O'Donnell's been holding on to that silver and gold bill forever. He said he didn't have the votes to get it out of committee. Well, I found out that that was not true. So at any rate, apparently it's starting to move now, and it's going to have an executive session on Tuesday this coming up week. So on Tuesday, basically the camera crew and also Daniel Diaz from Citizens for Sound Money are joining me, and we're going to be there and see that executive session, and then hopefully the same day see Bill Eigel with the Senate Bill 735 on the floor of the Senate in the same day and get all that on camera, you know, for, you know, the show. So we do have a lot of stuff going on. So we'll pay very close attention. We'll keep you guys updated. But I did tell you we were going to have a watch party on Tuesday night because of the elections that are going on in Missouri on Tuesday. That cannot happen now because Tuesday is dedicated to being up in Jeff City. So just so you guys know, there will be no live stream. Like I said, there would be, a watch party is what I called it, actually. But that will not happen now. But stuff is moving for gold and silver. But also, too, on Tuesday is election. So you want to make sure to go to, Ozarks Freedom Gal says, are they going to say, oops, clerical error again? I don't think so, because actually my understanding is Michael O'Donnell gave his word to Bill Eigel that 1955 would be exact on Tuesday. And I don't think he wants to make another clerical error after he's made the promise.
Yeah.
That's my guess. So, because I understand that they had a private conversation. I don't know what happened in the conversation, but they had a private conversation, and it was on the floor of the Senate. They had the conversation. So Representative O'Donnell happened to be in the Senate chamber. Bill, noticed him there and sat down and had a chat with him. So at any rate, so we have a lot of stuff going on this week. So let's recap again. I mean, silver and gold is moving. And I did put in the email what you can do. Because we're moving in the Senate again, please call your senator, sometime before Tuesday afternoon and reaffirm your support for silver and gold. And remember now, when you're calling a senator, or emailing a senator, it's not enough to say that you like the silver and gold bill, please say yes, or please vote yes. Give them specific reasons why you like the bill. This is really important. Please remember to do that. So it could be any number of generic reasons if you don't want to get in a big conversation, but if you're leaving a voicemail, just leave a simple explanation as to why you like the bill and why it would be good for Missouri. Remember now, you can call their offices 24/7, but if they're not open, obviously you can leave a voicemail. Many people choose to do that rather than talk to, you know, the LA or the senator. I prefer to talk to the politician direct if I can. But that's just my idea of what you should be doing right now that would help the bill. So on the House side, if you have not called everyone on that committee, and this would be the Financial Institutions Committee. Once again, it was linked in the email. So you should have it in previous emails, though, because we've linked it up quite a bit for many weeks, strung together. The Financial Committee or the Financial Institutions Committee, call up people in that committee. Remember now, when an elected official is serving on a committee, they actually serve the entire state in that capacity. So it doesn't matter if you live in Neosho and you're calling a representative that actually represents Kansas City if they're on the committee and you're talking about a bill in that committee. They serve the state when it comes to that committee, and that is the truth. So don't worry about, it's my representative's not on the Financial Institutions Committee. Doesn't matter. You're calling to them in their capacity for sitting on that committee. So let's call everyone on that committee, with the exception of O'Donnell. O'Donnell apparently doesn't like getting a lot of phone calls. We found that out the hard way. But at any rate, you could definitely call other people in the committee and let your opinion be known about the silver and gold bill. And that's really what we can do right now. On Tuesday, we'll be there. Daniel Diaz will be there. The producer of the show will be there. Cameras will be there. You know, lights, camera, action. And we're also going to be doing some interviews up there, you know, with specific people. So we're going to get that taken care of. Let's see. Ozarks Freedom Gal says, do repeat calls help or just annoy them? I'm happy to make another round of calls and send more emails. If you've already called everyone on the committee, I would suggest probably not calling them again. I have called everyone on the committee actually twice. So I have not emailed anyone on the committee, but I've called each and every one of them twice. And I was lucky. I actually talked to a couple of them. And then the others were LAs or voicemails. LA stands for legislative assistant, by the way. So I don't go beyond two. So that's kind of where I stop, because apparently I'm told my voice is very recognizable. So, but at any rate, that's up to the person. If you don't live in Missouri, I get this question all the time. If you don't live in Missouri, but you're considering moving to Missouri, please do call. You know, if you're considering moving here, and that silver and gold bill, you know, actually will help you make a decision whether or not you're going to move here, please feel free to call people on the committee. They don't often ask where you live, you know, so that's up to you if you tell them that. That doesn't generally happen. They, especially when you're calling on something that is specific to their committee responsibilities and not their just plain representative responsibilities. So they don't really care where you live when you're calling committee. They don't care as much. But that's what I would do. And guys, once again, I'm sorry about this whole, you know, thing with the phasing in and out here of Gilded. There's nothing I can do about it. It is a problem with Gilded. So I'm sorry about that for those who are watching as opposed to just listening. If you guys have any questions, I'm going to take a quick look at the streams again. But we are moving again. Silver and gold is definitely moving again, and it's hot. It's moving in both chambers at the same time. We didn't even have that last. Well, last year we only had the one bill. So this time we have several bills moving, and we have amendments moving, actually, on top of just our standard bills. So this is pretty exciting. Let's see. Checking for questions. Okay. Let's see. Workforce training, education. Okay, how do you, okay, hang on. We got questions about the school stuff, guys. So I think we covered the silver and gold stuff. And remember now, Citizens for Sound Money is coming to help us out too. I mean, we're very grateful to them for helping us out with our bill, knowing how difficult a time we're having with our current legislature. So Daniel Diaz will be here. Let's see. So now going back to education, because we actually have some questions on this. Let's see. Well, actually, not so much questions, but information. The MSBA lobbyist is the son of the State Board Education President, Charlie Shields. That's interesting. Let's see. Just wait into my April SBOE meeting when they propose the SEL standard mandates passed in HB 447. I have no idea about HB 447. I'm going to have to look that up. Maria says, how do we find info about the school board members? Sorry, I had to step away from my PC. Okay, pardon me. This is what I would do, Maria, under these circumstances. We'll have the gals chime in, too. Look and see if there's any information on Facebook on the people running for school board in your district. That's the most likely place that they are going to post their campaign. Remember now, school board in Missouri pays $0.00 per year. So unless you're Springfield and then you get $80,000 thrown at you to run for board member by a PAC, you know, so they can make sure to get the people they want in there, probably linked to Klaus Schwab again. We'd have to look into that. But that's how I would look into it and see if there's any listings on Facebook. If you don't have listings on Facebook, I would, actually it's getting late now, but you could actually call up the school and ask who has registered to run for school board and see if they have email addresses or phone numbers that they're allowing the public to have. That's the second way to find them. And you will definitely find them that way, but you have the vote on Tuesday, and a lot of people are taking Monday off, unfortunately, because it's the day after Easter. So that's
One thing. Another thing you can do is if there are school board members, go and look at their voting records. You can go up and find all the older agendas and minutes and everything, and you can see how they've been voting on different things that may interest you, such as one thing I'm, I have an upcoming article on a portrait of a graduate. Portrait of a graduate is complete SEL. You would be surprised, maybe you wouldn't be surprised, about how many schools have implemented portrait of a graduate. And you can trace that, believe it or not, back to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, I believe. And when you're looking at what they're doing, what they're pushing, what votes they've made, those are for those candidates who are already board members and are running. You can search around for that. Social media is another great big thing. There's a lot of candidates, more so those who've been on the boards are very active on social media with their comments about, you know, how wonderful their schools are. And
okay. That's a good idea, by the way. Thank you for that, Gretchen. And the next question is, what if they don't have a lot of info on Facebook? But there's another scenario I'd like to bounce off of you and, of course, Wonder Woman. And that is, what if you don't know who's running? New people that are running. But if you know the existing person who is up for election was very kind of tyrannical when it came to COVID stuff, right? So masking the kids, social distancing the kids, you know, that sort of thing, putting down all these regulations that came from the local health, you know, agency or whatever on the kids in the school, which are simply guidelines and not laws. So in my considered opinion, if you have someone on your board that participated in the COVID nonsense of masking kids and making them social distance, vote them out. Vote for the other person. Now, you don't know what you're getting with the new person. Sometimes the devil that you know is better than the devil you don't know. But chances are, if they're running against that person in that cycle, they probably have a problem with that person who is currently up for election. But it gets complicated when you have several people up for election at the same time. Sometimes there's good ones in there and bad ones. I'm going to let Wonder Woman and Gretchen chime in on this. Oh, it looks like we lost Wonder Woman.
Yeah, I don't know where she went. But, no, that is a very salient point. You can do that with your health boards too, because there's people up for running for health board. And if they were ones who were implementing everything that came down from FedGov and state recommendations, you're going to know that you're not going to elect those types of people. And that includes the school boards too, because most of them went right for it. They would, their superintendent got some kind of recommendation, recommended it to the school board, and the school board would go right for it without a second thought. So these are people who they obey their commanders up through the line. They do not think for themselves. And you've got to get people who are willing to speak the truth and willing to speak out. Here's Retha. She's back.
Yeah.
We lost her again. Yep. Lost her again.
She might be having technical difficulties. We're towards the end of the show, though. But Maria says, okay, thanks for the advice, Gretchen. So guys, I don't know what to tell you about some of this stuff because we are late in the game now. If you've not investigated things with the people running for school board, and I am guilty of that too, but at the same time, for the situation that we're dealing with in Clever, I think the new person who is running against the old person is the better choice. I'm sorry, the non school board person or the who's campaigning for school board is a better choice than the one who is on the school board who is up for reelection. That is Mr. Peebles. He's been there for some 28, 30 years on the school board. And so at any rate,
same with Patty Quisenberry in Ozark, who's been on for 27 years, and she was the one who actually made the first motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation to go with all those recommendations of the COVID mess.
Yep. And my thing would be, and by the way, that's a good point too, and especially with what's going on in Ozark, which is interesting all by itself, but the situation that we're dealing with here in Clever is I don't think Mr. Peebles is a bad man, but I think he made a lot of bad decisions. And you don't reward those bad decisions by keeping him in office where he implemented those bad decisions on children, masking children, social distancing children, and using, you know, basically all the tyranny that could come with decisions made by local health departments that were not ordinances, they were not laws, they were guidelines, they were recommendations. And the schools went with them hook, line, and sinker because there was grant money in it for them. So if you have someone on your board that literally was doing this to kids, masking the kids on the school buses and then taking federal money to do it, you know what to do. You should instinctively know what to do on that particular election. Mm-hmm. Elect out the person who got that grant money or got that federal money and masked the kids to do it. That's my opinion. And I'm sorry, I get passionate about that. The whole masking of the kids thing really made me angry. Really, I mean, with the public schools, that was terrible. But that's, once again, it's not just my opinion. It's the opinion of many doctors around the country, too, treating kids with breathing disorders from wearing masks for 2 years. So that's their opinion.
Well, what did that do? You wonder why there's bullying. You wonder why kids are angry. They put them in a fear state for so long.
Mm-hmm.
Scared of an invisible enemy. Mm-hmm. You know, it's that control valve, that boiling pot. And it's like, yeah, you're going to have some angry kids. Kids are mad, and they don't even know why they're mad. Yeah. They know something's
wrong.
That's
a great point. That's a great point.
Misty brings up something interesting. Misty Akison, do some backwards investigating. And who are the woke current school board members who aren't up for election supporting? That's a very good point. I never thought to look into that. Misty also says, who are the Democrats in your neighborhood and district supporting? So that's another good point. They don't often actually run as Democrat or Republican. They don't in Clever anyway. They may do in bigger districts. I don't know. But here they don't.
Well,
go ahead.
Not supposed to.
Yeah, in Springfield, the United Springfield or Springfield United PAC, I don't know if it's Springfield or Springfield United, that PAC claimed to be nonpartisan. And, you know, I wrote on my blog, I can about tell you who they're going to, you know, go for. And it was the woke people. And they did. They ended up endorsing the woke candidates. I think two of them are incumbents. And so look at what the PACs are doing. Do a little search on your local newspaper. School board candidates or whatever, you know, and you'll get a bunch of lies. It's fake news, but at least you can see how much money they've been getting from any PACs. You can see who's endorsing them, and that will go a long way towards letting you know who you want to vote for or not vote for.
Yep. Okay. I'm going to answer a few more questions here. Ozark's Freedom Gal says, what happened with O'Donnell rewriting the bill? He's still in the process of doing it, but he's been conferring with Senator Igel. So that much I know. I don't know anything more than that. Seriously, I don't. I don't know what O'Donnell's bill is going to look like yet. We have to wait for it to come out. So let's see. And then Ozark's Freedom Gal says, know your neighbors and judge them by their yard signs. This is a valid vetting process. Oh, do I know that, Freedom's Gal. We know that quite a bit. When you're in a cul-de-sac in the middle of nowhere and your neighbors are putting up By the way, cul-de-sac in the middle of nowhere is actually relative and germane, because that's where we live.
Yeah, it's accurate.
And when you have your neighbors around the cul-de-sac putting up the, you know, the go ahead and vote, you know, April 2nd, you know, for the school bond issue, when no one comes down here, it's pretty strange. It's like they're all, you know, advertising to
the mailman. The mailman does.
The mailman. That's right. The mailman comes down this way. So that the
he lives in Republic. So
yeah, the Amazon delivery man, the mailman. You know, that's who they're advertising to. That's a great comment, by the way. Sure. I love that. Thank you for that. Okay, looking here. Let's see. No, school board races are nonpartisan. But if you know who the Democrats are, you can watch who they support. Yep. Well, we don't know much about the races in our area. We didn't pay as much attention to that, and that's our fault, but we've been concentrating on school bond issues all over the state, actually, so between my wife and I. So we've not paid attention to the people running, but we do know that Mr. Peebles and Clever, and I'm not saying he's a bad guy. I'm not saying that at all. He's been very nice to us. He seems like a genuinely nice man, but he has made some bad decisions. He made bad decisions along with the rest of the board, and now he's up for election, and, you know, so people need to take that into account. And I'm talking about the COVID stuff. I'm talking about the use of the language, no tax increase bond issue, because, you know, he runs the board, and he approved that language usage. So he approved deceptive languages on the ballot. But he also made bad decisions during COVID for masking the kids on the school buses, and that went on for... Dear God, Retha, how long did that go on for? A year? A whole year, maybe?
Yeah, it was at least a year.
Yep. And
it seemed like.
And they did it for federal money. They took the federal money. And so that was the requirement.
That was gear.
That was what? I'm sorry?
It was gear money.
Gear?
Oh, gear.
Okay.
Yep.
So.
They got buses.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. So I'm taking that information into account. And I know the person who is running against him was not on the board and did not make these bad decisions. So I'm willing to give them a chance. Now, once again, it's important you guys understand, I don't have anything personally against Mr. Peebles. I have a problem with some decisions he made on the school board is all. And he may have made those with the best intentions, but masking the kids for a year to take federal money, I'm sorry. There's no excuse you can give me that you didn't know at that time, because by that time we all knew masking was a very bad idea for kids, very bad. And they didn't care. They literally didn't care. They wanted the federal money so bad, they masked up those kids on the school buses for an entire year. That's my opinion, by the way. I don't claim to be a scientist.
It's called trafficking the kids for money.
Yep. Trafficking kids for money. That's right. You know.
Perfect.
Yep. Okay. Any other questions? Let's see. Before we wrap up, I want to remind everyone that tomorrow's Easter, if you didn't know. I'm sure most of you did know. But make sure to make some time for your risen King, you know? Make sure you know how much, you know, you appreciate the risen King. And I pray every night before I go to bed. Actually, while I'm actually laying in bed, I pray. And one of the things that I pray for, And I encourage other people to do this, is to ask God to become a part of the plan. Because asking God for things that you want may not be part of the plan. So I just ask God to include me in the plan. Show me the way. Tell me what I need to do. So that's kind of the prayer that I do when I go to bed. Also, I ask if I've offended anyone to please forgive me. At any rate, since it's Easter, I thought I would share that with you guys. That's kind of the prayer I do when I go to bed at night. So, but be sure to, you know, make some time for your families too. You know, Easter's, you know, a very, very important holiday for families as well. But I want to thank you once again for spending time with the Missouri Freedom Initiative. Once again, Saturday nights, it seems to be about 2 hours per show. I hope we give you relevant data, especially if you're in the state of Missouri. If you're not in the state of Missouri and you're watching us and learning what we do, great. Take that knowledge and start working your own state for freedom and for liberty. Because if you don't do it, no one else will. Retha and I know that very firsthand, actually. So, you know, actually it's almost incumbent upon you once you get the knowledge on what to do in your state, you know, basically what to do with your schools, with the bonds and people running for board. Don't keep it to yourself. Share that information. Make sure that other people know, because we all know we're losing our freedoms. And the plan is using the 10th Amendment to make sure that Missouri maintains and keeps and actually gets back all of its freedoms. That's basically what it is. It's tantamount to what the Free State Project is doing in New Hampshire. It's kind of the same thing. So gold and silver legislation is very important, but it's also important that, you know, that our kids are not trapped into, you know, basically SB 727 for a lot of different reasons. We have a lot of work to do in the state of Missouri. We have never claimed to be perfect. And yes, we do have a rhino problem and a corporatist problem up in Jefferson City. But it's because of all of you who work with us that we're actually able to make positive change. So once again, I want to say how much I appreciate those who participate in this experiment we call liberty, or some people call freedom. They often mean the same thing. Liberty does have a different connotation, though, than just freedom does. But I want to say how much I appreciate all the activity in the state of Missouri and everyone who participates, no matter what grassroots group you're in. The very fact that you show up at the Capitol makes you a superman, gives you superpowers beyond what most people could possibly imagine in their state. Because once you start showing up to the Capitol and you start talking to politicians, they have to start listening. And when you're taking up their time, a lobbyist isn't. That's how powerful this is. Okay. Before I sign off, does anyone have any final words for tonight? Nope. Okay. Go ahead, Caleb.
Polls open at 6 Tuesday.
6 o'clock. So, thank you.
Yep. So at least they do in Cass County, but I think it's statewide. So, you know. If you end up going to, we have another people come to the Capitol Tuesday, or is that
Tuesday? I'm not asking for people to come up. They're welcome to come up because we have silver and gold activity, but it's floor time on the Senate and it's executive session time in the House. So it's not something people can really participate in. It's something they can be there to witness.
Yeah, that's fair. So, but if you are coming up to the Capitol, go ahead and vote before you show up.
Absolutely. That's good advice.
And votes do count.
Yes,
and
that's
on
right.
On local elections, every vote counts.
Yep. Particularly on elections like this in small towns, because sometimes you get like 10 people show up.
That's right. And, you know, a lot of times it seems like we don't have any say-so on what happens on the national level. But we sure can hold strong on the local level.
Absolutely, we can.
As we gain our freedoms back on the local level, we can move up to the state level and then keep going. So it's so important to be active on the local level and vote.
That's right. Be active on the local level and do it for the kids. Because they need you to step up and make sure that they have their freedoms.
Of course, you got to say do it for the kids.
I do it every – I wink when I say it too because, you know, once again, I really do believe that we need to save freedom for the kids. I actually do believe
Wouldn't you want your kids free rather than to have a performing arts center? You know, freedom is more important than a performing arts center. Being able to read and write and reason is more important than getting – X amount of federal or state dollars for whatever projects, having your taxes raised in order to give kids something that is just surface stuff. It's surface. It's not the important things they need.
Now, hang on. You're saying we shouldn't be throwing out senior citizens from their homes so we can have AstroTurf at the high school?
No. Our senior citizens are important members of the
That's
community.
Right.
And if you throw them out of their homes, number one, you're gonna lose your inheritance, okay, if you're a parent.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's it.
And your parent and the grandparents gonna have. So, I mean, let's think about what happens when you throw somebody out of their home over a matter of a few hundred dollars. I mean, so many people are on fixed incomes, and it's just cruel.
A few hundred dollars.
Listen, I heard our county, I don't know, remember if it was the assessor or I think it was our county assessor. He told a tragic story of a woman who was on the verge of losing her home over about $90, okay, her taxes. She could not pay it. Somebody ended up paying it for her. But that's how close to the edge a lot of elderly people are. And it's just darn cruel and evil.
Yep. You should see how Jackson County is. Jackson County is absolutely awful. My grandparents paid $9,000.
Yep. It's getting bad. And once again, we warn about this all the time in the Missouri Freedom Initiative. We do not want Missouri to become Illinois. And we're at the precipice right now. I mean, with all these schools going for, you know, not all of them, but a lot of them going to max out their bonding capacity and doing stuff like AstroTurf and bleachers and, you know, performing arts centers while they max out their bonding capacity, to me is insulting. Absolutely insulting. And there are people that will say that it's important, the kids need that. That's simply not true. What it does do is it grows government. It grows the government school. It grows the amount of money that they need to keep maintaining everything they have there. It is a never-ending perpetual cycle of debt with the public schools. When is the last time you got a tax break on your personal property tax or on your property tax because a bond slipped off at your school district? You don't. It almost never happens because they work extra hard in overtime to make sure that they can get a brand new bond voted in before the old one expires. That way they can keep it going forever and ever. And then eventually they don't have enough maintenance money. They will raise the levy. And that's permanent. You can't get rid of that. So keep in mind, you know, basically, and this is my opinion, but if your school it has grade problems. And by the way, there's several ways to look this up. And Missouri Education said that not all the information is totally reliable, and I understand that. But the fact of the matter is we do have problems in Missouri with grades. That is a fact. And I'm not harping on the teachers. I'm not harping on the kids. I'm harping on the entire system that is okay with the kids failing. They're okay with it. As long as they get the money, they're okay that kids are failing. They'll give them a D and slip them through the system. And that's not okay. We send the kids there and we pay a lot of money for them to get an education. They're failing. And by the way, many public schools admit this. Not all of them, but some of them actually admit that the system has failed the kids. And for that reason, a lot of them get out of the MSBA system, you know, the Missouri School Board Association. So they can have a little more local control to try and get their grades up. And we'll talk more about that later. I do need to close out the live stream. I want to thank everyone again for joining us, particularly in the panel. We don't have Kirby here anymore, but Kirby Lane was with us earlier talking about SB 727. We really appreciate her insights. She has really studied that bill, by the way. She has broken it apart and up and down and left and right and she has really found a lot of scary stuff in that bill. But we've had Caleb with us tonight. Of course, we've had Gretchen Garrity. Please check out her blog. It's listed below in the description section of this live stream. It was also in the email. Bookmark her blog. It is updated constantly, sometimes is with as many as 3 stories per day. And it pertains to education and library systems right here in the state of Missouri. I want to thank Voodoo for being with us. Of course, Shane, Ancient Tom, and Wonder Woman. Thank you all for being with us on all of the socials. I want to say, once again, happy Easter to everyone. May God bless each and every one of you and your families. Don't forget Tuesday, gang. Don't forget to vote on Tuesday. You all take care.